Here is an excerpt from chapter 14 titled Soul Factories, from Nick Redfern's book, Final Events and the Secret Government Group on Demonic UFOs and the Afterlife, released in 2010. A special episode referred to me by my friend Lucy from the website alien.love. Be sure to check them out sometime. As the operations personnel listened carefully and intently, Manza related that some 7 months earlier, the Collins elite had been in contact with a man named Paul Garrett, a house painter, who had recently come to their attention after he was involved in a near-fatal and horrific car crash on a stretch of highway outside of San Francisco, California. After a fast-paced ambulance drive, his heart briefly stopped beating in the hospital to which he was taken. Fortunately, he was resuscitated and ultimately made a successful and complete recovery. While in his practically deceased state, however, Garrett underwent a bizarre and frightening so-called near-death experience, which he briefly discussed in a letter to his local newspaper after his return to full health. It was this communication to the press, in which Garrett described seeing numerous UFOs in some hellish realm while the doctors worked frantically to kickstart his heart, that led a representative of the Collins elite to tactfully approach Garrett, albeit under somewhat deliberately misleading circumstances. Garrett was reportedly given a cover story that the people interested in his case were actually U.S. Army psychologists, working on a project attached to the University of South Carolina to understand and alleviate mental trauma in military personnel who had been exposed to the horrors of warfare in Vietnam and who were specifically being plagued by horrific dreams, as Garrett most certainly was after his experience. One of the central aspects of the project, Garrett was falsely told, focused on the study of soldiers whose dreams, just like Garrett's, involved graphic visions of hell. He had been experiencing, Garrett agreed to spend a couple of days at the University of South Carolina, where, Manners explained, a consultant to the Collins elite had an office that would serve as a suitable location for an in-depth interview and medical study of Garrett to be undertaken. It is also worth noting, and it may be of some relevance, that personnel from Operation Often, under the guise of a bogus outfit called the Scientific Engineering Institute, funded a course in sorcery at the very same University of South Carolina in the early 1970s. As for near-death experiences, or NDEs, as they have become known, they generally refer to a broad range of personal experiences reported by people who have either been on the verge of death, or who have indeed briefly passed away before being resuscitated, and which can encompass multiple strange sensations including detachment from the body, feelings of levitation, extreme fear, overwhelming serenity, security, or warmth, the experience of absolute dissolution, and the presence of a brightly lit tunnel, which some people interpret as a deity itself, or that others perceive as a gateway or pathway through which a person ultimately enters into the mysterious realm of the afterlife. Garrett also experienced this ubiquitous tunnel of bright light, but he was suddenly and violently hauled from its comforting glow and enveloping warmth into a far darker and much colder dimension. Garrett told the doctor who was consulting for the Collins elite that he felt himself falling at high speed, which with hindsight, later made him wonder if he was actually descending into the very pits of hell itself. But, if his final destination was hell, then it was certainly not a hell like that described in the pages of the Bible or traditionally portrayed in Christian teachings. As the doctor listened carefully and took copious notes, and as both a microphone and a hidden camera recorded his every word, Garrett said that he was confronted by a never-ending, utterly flat, light blue, sandy landscape that was dominated by a writhing mass of an untold number of naked human beings, screaming in what sounded like torturous agony. Above them, he saw a purple sky filled with hundreds of flying saucer, like objects that pulsed and throbbed, almost as if they were living, breathing entities in their own right. The objects busily raced back and forth across the skyline in a fashion that Garrett likened to seemingly metallic soldier, ants or worker, bees performing never-ending vitally important tasks. Garrett never felt the calmness and tranquility that others who have experienced NDEs have reported. Quite the opposite, in fact. His mind, or his disembodied life, force perhaps, was in utter turmoil as he watched the flying saucer, like craft, suddenly slow down their movements to an eventual standstill high above the mass of people below, and then bathed each and every one of them in a green, sickly glow. What happened next was even worse, Garrett told the doctor. Small balls of light seemed to fly from the bodies of the people into the green glow. These small balls were then sucked up into the flying saucers. At that point, An eerie and deafening silence overcame the huge mass of people, who duly rose to their feet as one and collectively stumbled and shuffled in the hundreds of thousands across the barren landscape, like in a George Romero zombie movie, towards a large black hole that had now materialized in the distance. Suddenly, Garrett felt disorientated, and the next thing he knew, he was groggily coming to his senses in a hospital bed. Thanks to the work of the doctors, he firmly believed he had been spared the wrath of the Grim Reaper and the devil himself. Garrett admitted to the doctor at the University of South Carolina that he was not a particularly religious man, but he had come to a terrifying conclusion about his experience. Either it had all been a horrible and vivid nightmare provoked by his subconscious as he neared death, or he had briefly visited the gateway to hell itself, a place where living machines matching the descriptions of flying saucers literally harvested human souls. Those countless balls of light that he saw exiting the bodies of the huge throng, which he also concluded were being utilized to fuel those piloting the craft. Then, after the reaping was over, the now soulless and zombie-like multitude took its inevitable stumbling steps that led towards the bleak and foreboding dark hole that had appeared in the distance, and finally onto the road to hell.